Good afternoon, everybody. If you haven't had your taken your seat, if you want to please do that, we're going to go ahead and get started. So I'm Michelle Wickett, your board chair, and I am with Axia Home Loans, and I am happy to see all of you here, so thank you for joining us. The first thing that we want to do today is, of course, appreciate all of our chamber ambassadors for all of that they do. So if they want to stand and we can acknowledge them, they're the ones that are greeting you and signing you in and going to all of the different events, so we want to appreciate them for all they do. And then we want to always acknowledge our ambassador sponsorship, which is through TAGS Awards and Specialties. So thank you to TAGS Awards and Specialties. Try to say that really fast. Okay. So if you want to take a look at upcoming events, there's a couple of changes that I want to bring to your attention. We have the Distinguished Leadership Awards, which has been moved out to May 11th. So just be aware of that one. Find Your Future, which is a March 19th. The Math for Life, which is coming up. And then A Night on the Town, we're very likely going to be moving that one out. So stay tuned just to see. That was a March event, so we'll see how the current variant affects that or not. But we will give you announcements as we move forward on that one. And that is what we have for upcoming events. So our next big one is going to be bringing David forward so we can welcome him, and he will go through the sponsorships.
How's everyone doing? Great, good. So I was chatting with several people, and this is Groundhog Day. Seems like the COVID experience will never end, and maybe we just need to figure out how we adjust and manage it. But if you're feeling like this is a little similar to last year, it is and it isn't. It's nice to have all of you here today. It's nice to see people in person and have conversations and, of course, connect. It is a pleasure, once again, for the Chamber to host our community's State of the Community addresses. The intent is for us to provide an opportunity for our local government leadership, the mayors and the county commission chair, to share what is happening in their communities and the state of activity in their respective jurisdictions. A real big thank you to PSE, Puget Sound Energy. For years, Puget Sound Energy has been the sponsor and supporter of the State of the Community event. And we really appreciate that. PSC, everyone knows, is very engaged in our community. They support local organizations, and they are, I definitely consider them one of our community's community building entities. So thank you to PSC for your support. Once again, for the State of the Community, if we could just applaud and thank them for that, I would appreciate it. Well, the format is similar. As previous years, we'll have a report out by each individual jurisdiction, and then we'll have a conversation on significant issues. I will be posing those in a question, but hopefully, I know, the ball will just get rolling once the cat's out of the bag. Prior to this event, we did ask our distinguished individuals that are here today presenting the State of the Community a couple questions, and we published those questions in The Voice. The first question we asked was, heading into 2022, what positive changes do you see for the local economy? And the second question was, what exciting new public projects are on the horizon for your community? If you want the answers to those, we have some voices on the table, and feel free to skim those, or you're welcome to get it off our website as well. But very insightful, and it was exciting to hear some of the things that are occurring within our community. So a couple things. Little housekeeping. Heads up to the audience. We'll be running until about 1:15. We like to grab a little bit extra time. Just so that we can provide an opportunity for dialogue. And to our speakers, I know I have already shared this, but just one more time, we're going to start out with our order of individual presentations with Mayor Andy Ryder, City of Lacey, and then Mayor Cheryl Selby, City of Olympia, Mayor Debbie Sullivan, new mayor, Debbie Sullivan. Joe DePinto, new mayor. Joe, congratulations. City of Yelm will be next. And then we'll have, of course, our county chair, commission chair type, Menser, wrapping things up from that perspective. And with that, why don't we get started? Yeah, let's just kick things right off. Are we ready with Mayor Ryder, who is virtually meeting with us today? Mayor Ryder, welcome. Do we have voice?
Thank you.
Okay, we're good to go. All right, Mayor Ryder, the next several few minutes or so is all yours, so have at it.
Thank you. I was really looking forward to being with you all today, but unfortunately, I was exposed to COVID the week before last, so I'm just being extra precautious. It's another reminder that this health pandemic is not yet over. However, there are many positives to be excited about. You know, economic growth has picked up in many places, including Lacey. Local spending has rebounded in most retail sectors. In fact, we are going to hit record sales tax collection in 2021, which has continued a trend going back into 2020 in Lacey. Reflecting back on the past 2 years, one of the most remarkable things I witnessed throughout this pandemic has been the sustained level of collaboration and partnership from all components of the community. We all came together, and together we have been stronger. However, COVID response is not the only area that needs strong collaboration. The City of Lacey and the region recognizes that we need to work together to address other pressing community-wide issues, in particular, homelessness. Former Governor Greg Barsh spoke to this chamber last month about this very subject, and I agree with the essential elements she outlined as a part of her work with Challenge Seattle. There's a need for real-time data to understand the scope of the problem, as well as track progress. The homeless population that is battling drug addiction, mental illness, and other behavioral health issues that are often the most visible in our community need direct specialized services. We also need standards for accountability to restore the public's confidence as we spend increased tax dollars to address this complex problem. For Lacey's part, we have pledged our American Rescue Plan Act dollars to $7 million to construct permanent supportive housing. In fact, Lacey is working in partnership with Thurston County for a potential purchase of a hotel to make progress on this goal. There's no doubt that our region needs more permanent supportive housing. And I want to applaud Olympia, Tumwater, and Thurston County for all they have done to work regionally on this issue. And I know that work is continuing. Successful partnerships start with good communication. And now more than ever, we need to be communicating better and agree on how the region's going to put standards in place so we're not just moving this issue from one jurisdiction to the next. However, we also need the business community support and understanding when it comes to selecting sites for permanent supported housing as well. I often hear that refrain that everyone wants homelessness to be addressed, but no one wants homeless resources located near them. As business owners, we know economic vitality will suffer if we cannot manage the homeless crisis effectively. And if we cannot work together, we'll ultimately fail together. Another challenging issue our region is confronting is affordable housing. This hurts our communities, but it also affects businesses. I know firsthand how difficult it has been for some of my employees to find affordable housing here in Thurston County. One of the many ways the City of Lacey is working on this issue is by removing barriers to create affordable housing. A great example of this is our innovative award-winning pre-approved accessory dwelling unit program. But this isn't enough. Building off the momentum of past efforts, the City of Lacey will consider three major initiatives to increase affordable housing within our community. First, to help spur the development of more affordable housing options, the city is looking at rezoning residential areas with the lowest density requirements to allow for the development of up to 6 units per acre, as well as allowing existing homes to be converted to duplexes or triplexes. Second, the city is looking to extend its affordable housing fee waiver program to include private sector builders. In the past, this waiver helped Habitat for Humanity build a 33-unit affordable housing development. Under this program, the city would consider waiving building, mechanical, plumbing, electrical, plan check, and water meter fees for affordable housing units built by the private sector. And the third initiative will be to consider extending the multifamily tax exemption program. We have seen this model work, developer MJR is currently constructing a mixed-use project in Midtown, where they took advantage of this program that includes retail, 151 units, and will serve as a catalyst for a burgeoning urban core. In the future, we need to have a broader policy discussion on how we promote affordable housing efforts beyond this area. But I am happy to report Lacey has experienced a record number of permits issued for multifamily units in 2021, and multifamily construction is anticipated to remain strong for the foreseeable future, with over 2,600 units in the planning pipeline over the next few years. We also have a number of exciting commercial opportunities coming to Lacey. Coastal Farms will be backfilling the old Shopko building. We'll be welcoming Tech Equipment, a semi-truck and trailer dealership, and NC Machinery, a heavy equipment retail and repair shop, both of which will be located in Northeast Lacey. And public safety will also be a focus for and a priority for our community in the coming year. Lacey's current police station is approaching its fourth decade, and a lot has changed since 1985. With this in mind, the Lacey City Council approved the exploration of a new site for a future police station. It's likely that the development of this facility will cost over $40 million and it will require the community's approval. We'll be setting up a community group shortly to help guide this much needed public investment. And finally, the last item I want to touch on is a game changer for the region. When finished, it will be a significant attraction and asset for the greater Thurston County area. After 2 years of planning, outreach, and engagement, we're ready to introduce the final design for the Greg Cuyo Park and Greenways. At 537 acres, it contains irreplaceable natural areas, including wetlands, wildlife, creeks, forests, ravines, and so much more. It'll definitely be a premier attraction as part of Lacey's first-class park system. Look for updates as the city develops its access points for Lacey's largest park. I couldn't possibly express all the great things that are going on in Lacey and the time allotted, but I'd like to personally invite you to come invest in Lacey, place where businesses have the opportunity to thrive, and I'm always happy to talk to you about the benefits of doing business in Lacey in more detail. The resources and support Lacey provides our business community is one of the many reasons why Wallet Hub named Lacey as the best small city in Washington State to start a business in March of last year. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mayor Ryder. Mayor Selby. Come on up. Oh, no. Yeah, come on. Yeah. And then I'll bring you all up together.
Okay, got it. Every year it's a little different, right? All right. So, good afternoon, and thank you for once again for providing time for some brief insights into what's going on in our communities. This is my seventh time standing before you, and I'm happy to share the stage with a couple of new faces. Of course, we're not up here this time, but we will be sharing the stage with a couple of new faces. So welcome Joe DePinto and Debbie Sullivan. Last year we met remotely, and I chose to share two videos that captured the impact of the tumult of 2020. One portrayed the resilience our city mustered while managing the pandemic, and the second highlighted the social justice reckoning that hit our streets after the murder of George Floyd. I'm heartened to say, a year later, while still facing the challenges of the pandemic, the city has taken great strides in doing the hard work of incorporating diversity, equity, and belonging into the decision-making of every policy. Today, I'll cover the top three priorities for the City of Olympia for 2022. So reimagining public safety. We established a community work group to lead the public process for reimagining public safety. Our goal is to understand the what, why, and how of current programs and departments with the intention of creating a public safety ecosystem where everyone is treated equally under the law and feels safe asking an officer for help. We'll strive to look at the public safety system holistically and include every touch point from an EMT call to a probation officer visit and make sure our personnel have the right tools and proper training to do their jobs safely and equitably. We're also working to help draft amendments to the public safety bills that were passed in the 2021 legislature, specifically regarding use of force. Those bills actually had the opposite effect and left people confused and our first responders feeling less safe in many instances where mental health calls were involved. I'm proud to say that our in-house legal team has been influential in working with the bill writers to clarify these issues and are helping to draft clarifying amendments as we speak for this session. Under housing and homelessness, Mayor Ryder covered a broad part of that, so I won't repeat what he had to say, but I want to say for the City of Olympia, we're getting back on track with the One Community Plan that was adopted at the end of 2019. This plan incorporated the broadest input we could capture from our community on developing a path forward to manage our homeless population that would balance compassion with accountability. It took a back seat as we were thrown into crisis management during COVID, and we're still trying to deal with that outfall. On a more hopeful note, we ended 2021 with a ribbon cutting on our first home fund project called Unity Commons out on Martin Way. It's 60 units of permanent supportive housing with a 53-bed attached shelter. We're very encouraged that the county will pass their own home fund measure this month. Olympia plans to combine our program with theirs for a collective impact and develop more projects like Unity Commons more quickly in the future. I would also like to thank the Chamber for supporting the work of the statewide coalition to address chronic homelessness. Hearing former Governor Chris Gregoire speak at a forum this fall about her coalition should give us all hope that this will get the urgent attention it deserves during our current legislative session. And indeed, the governor's budget has set aside $334 million to provide emergency capital to purchase multifamily housing and hotels. Under economic development, as many of you know, it's been a priority of mine to promote arts, cultures, and heritage of our capital city. So it was a thrilling milestone when we were awarded the deed to the historic Olympia Armory at the end of 2021. This building was actually called out as a property that we wanted to acquire back in our 2002 parks plan, so now it's finally happened. We just completed a community outreach process in our staging plans to turn the property into a regional creative campus. As a complement, the City Council unanimously approved an April ballot measure to establish a cultural access program. I can explain more about that later if there's an opportunity. There's a campaign now underway called Inspire Olympia, and I am working very hard with Patty Belmonte from the Hands-On Children's Museum and Jill Barnes from the Washington Center and a host of other organizations to get this to be passed in April. It would provide, amongst many things that it would provide, it could help with free and reduced access to art, culture, heritage, and science programming, and many other ways that we can provide equity into accessing all of our regional assets around arts, cultures, and heritage. As a cultural hub, the economic impact of supporting the arts has a ripple effect for the entire region. So again, thanks for your time, and I look forward to taking questions when we get to that from our moderator. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Mayor Selby, as I lose my glasses and lost my mask. And anyway, I wouldn't want the headline, Mayor, to be you stumble off the stage and incurred injuries at a chamber forum presentation. So, but thank you. Very much appreciated. New mayor, I hope you don't mind me calling you the new mayor. It's so much fun to have a new mayor in Tumwater, Mayor Sullivan.
So I want to thank everyone for this opportunity to speak to you. I've been in office now for 12 days, so we hit the ground running, don't we? So I really appreciate it. So I want to begin by thanking the voters and the residents of my community for making me the first woman elected mayor of the city of Tumwater. The So I really do feel that this is an amazing honor, and I really do appreciate it. And we're ready to embrace this moment. We have new council members, and we now have a new diversity upon our council. We have the first elected black male council member and the first black female council member. So we are making amazing strides in Tumwater. So first I want to say it gives me great hope, and I'm sure all of us are, that somehow we get to the end of this pandemic. It looks like we're going to be in another round here shortly, but I'm hoping that we as communities can collaborate and help our communities and our businesses and all of those manage through this next wave of the pandemic. And I want to make sure that we have strong relationships with our community leaders, our business leaders, and other elected officials. For almost 2 years, the pandemic has profoundly impacted our communities and businesses and our lives. Thurston's strong partnership has helped mitigate some of the financial impacts of local businesses throughout the county. Heading into 2022, there are signs of sustained recovery, and I'm very optimistic. Businesses are expanding, new commercial buildings are being constructed, new neighborhoods are being built, and the existing homes are being renovated, signaling economic stability and growth in the retail sales. There is continued growth in the real estate market and residential development. We know that this is a direct connection between housing and the economic vitality. I'm happy to report the housing boom in Tumwater is going strong, and residential construction has reached levels that we have never seen before. With 242 single-family homes and 145 multifamily unit permits this last year has increased our inventory to more affordable housing. Tumwater is ready for new business and residential development and commercial properties with mixed use, mixed income housing, and no report about Tumwater would be complete without mentioning the brewery. There is continued community support for rehabilitation of and preservation of the old brew tower, and we see more favorable conditions ahead for private fundraising. Phase one work construction for the new roof, brick replacement, and masonry restoration is complete, and phase two for seismic stabilization is in the design. Our former brewery property and craft district is built around South Puget Sound Community College Brewing and Distilling Program, and it opened last June with Heritage Brewing and Distilling. An outdoor amphitheater is going to be opened this summer, and market building, which will have retail shops, cafes, and other craft products producers, is in development. This year, our work to promote Tumwater as a destination for things craft is spotlight the people, places, and businesses that are unique to Tumwater. Craft brewing and distilling and cider make local farmers and marketing, trails, parks, and Tumwater Falls. And collaboration with Olympia, Lacey, and Thurston County, we will continue to support the economic recovery initiatives, regional housing solutions, and implementing of climate action plan. There are lots of good things going on in Tumwater and more to come in 2022, and I look forward to working with all of you and making this community great in the year 2022. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Well, it's exciting to introduce another new individual to the State of the Community Address. Would you please welcome Mayor Joe DePinto with City of Yelm. Mm-hmm.
Welcome. Good afternoon, everyone. I appreciate the Thurston County Chamber for giving us the opportunity to showcase our cities, give the State of the Community. It's a little surreal being up here with all the other mayors from the bigger cities in Thurston County. I wish I was up here 4 years ago, but a landslide of 14 votes prevented that. But looking at the bigger picture, I think that the extra 4 years on city council has helped me prepare and to lead the city that I've loved so much. I moved to Yelm when I was 5 years old. My parents had just bought a restaurant in Rainier. The time was called Joey's, now it's called Sonia's. I grew up in Yelm attending all the schools from Prairie Elementary to Yelm High School. I was part of the group of students and went to Washington, D.C. to sing to President Clinton way back in the day, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Suffice to say, Yelm has treated me very well, gave me a wonderful childhood. I'm so grateful that I can give back something to the community that has given me so much. And it's helped me mold me into the person and the man that I am today. And when I say it's my honor to be mayor of Yelm, my hometown, I mean that with all my heart. I'm a product of Yelm, 100%. It's my pleasure to tell you the state of our community is strong. When I moved to Yelm in the early 90s, we had a population of around 2,000. Since then, we've been in the top 10 fastest growing cities in Washington State. And today we have a little over 10,000 inside our city limits. This doesn't include the 30,000 or so residents that are just outside our city limits that shop at our stores, go to our schools, contribute to our community. I very much consider them a part of Yelm as well. Now, there have been growing pains along the way, and the city's had to deal with some of the expansion and updating our infrastructure to accommodate our growth. And while I didn't always agree with decisions made by past councils and mayors, they did hand off to me a pretty solid foundation. The city of Yelm is in good financial state. Standard & Poor's global bond ratings raised its long-term rating to AA- for the city of Yelm during their most recent financial review. It's an excellent high-grade rating for a smaller city. In our city coffers, we've maintained very strong reserves during our past three audited fiscal years, which helped contribute to this strong rating, along with a strong economy, and despite being largely built out with ongoing and planned residential and commercial growth. And we're about to see an explosion of growth as we've just secured our new water rights. We have a little less than a month till everything's official, but we're already seeing a huge lineup of businesses and residential permits just ready for us to give them the green light to build. And speaking of permits, we've already seen a large increase of building permit revenue with new growth of nearly 70% over the past 3 years. Our sales tax revenue is also on the up and up with an increase of 34.5% during that same time period. And I also want to highlight our real estate excise tax, our revenue that has seen a 50% increase since 2019. We're on secure financial footing and are poised to have a really big year in 2022. One very exciting project is just on the horizon, and that's the SR-510 Yelm Loop, or the Yelm Bypass, as some people call it. This fully funded project is in its second and final phase of construction, with actual construction starting in 2023 and looking to be completed by early 2025. The Yelm Loop will run from one end of our town to the other and come out where the Walmart is currently. And it's going to increase freight mobility, decrease traffic in our downtown core, and provide new opportunities for economic development along its path. I'm delighted to see this project come to fruition and be the mayor that sees it completion due to the vision and hard work of previous city councils and mayors. We're doing a lot of exciting and new things, but what I'm most proud about in Yelm is our employees. I'm sure all the mayors here would argue that they have some special people, some of the best employees around, but for real, we have some real special people in Yelm. And one of our shining stars in the audience today, and that's Cody Colt. Cody, would you mind standing up real fast? He's our public services director. He used to be our public works director, but we merged to public services director. And I actually went to school with Cody. He was a couple years older than me, but we were friends and we played on the high school tennis team together. After serving our country in the Navy, he came back to teach at our schools. He then ran for city council and had won against an incumbent, which some of you know in here is no easy feat. He did great on council, but decided to apply to be our public works director, and our last mayor hired him. And I still think that's JW's best hire that he ever made. Some people question the hire since his only public works experience was on a naval vessel, which is a little bit different from a municipality. But I knew right away he was the right person for the job. And fast forward today, he has transformed the department into a lean, mean, street cleaning, water gleaming, and budget trimming machine. He's doing an amazing job, and his employees really love him. Another priceless gem we have in Yelm is our police chief and current city administrator, Todd Stansel. Todd, would you mind, chief? Stand up. I won't say as much about the chief, since he's actually from Rainier, and he doesn't really need me to stroke his big ego anyway. So, but I'm really proud and happy with how he stepped up as the interim city administrator, and he's made the transition from the Foster administration to my own really smooth, and so I'm really grateful, and thank you for that, chief. He was first hired as a city as a patrol officer in the 90s, and then he eventually became our police chief in the early 2000s. Despite growing up in Rainier, which I don't hold against him, he's had a history of service for the city of Yelm, including personally for me as my DARE officer in elementary school and football coach at Yelm Middle School. I know you wouldn't expect me to play football. That's a real surprise. But he's given a lifetime of service to my community, and he's doing one heck of a job as state administrator. So he's keeping our department heads on track, assisting them when needed, and he's doing a great job. His years of experience and knowledge of our city has proven to be a good fit as interim city administrator, and whoever appointed him deserves a huge pat on the back. Lastly, I want to highlight the importance of South County and my commitment to the sometimes forgotten cities of Thurston County. I truly appreciate being invited to this, but I feel the mayors of Rainier, Tenino, and the town of Pocota should also be up here too. They often get left out or marginalized when it comes to grants from the county or state, regional stakeholder groups, events like these, or even roundtable discussions with congressional or state leaders. I understand that sometimes the big dogs of Thurston County got to eat, but there needs to be some more equity in some of the smaller communities here in Thurston County as well, which just happens to be in South County. I think one rock star of an advocate we have here is George Sharp for STEADY. I don't know if George is around tonight. He might be, maybe not, but he's part of STEADY, though, the South Thurston Economic Development Initiative, which I'm grateful that Thurston EDC funds. George has done amazing things for South County, and our communities are all very grateful to him. I hope to work with George and even more, and will commit some resources in the city of Yelm to help bolster STEADY and economic growth in South County. That said, I'm still looking forward to working with all of Thurston County and the leaders of each city, and the business leaders of the county as well. Yelm isn't that small town full of rednecks and farmers anymore, as you might be able to tell here. But we're really poised, though, for large economic growth. We're professionalizing our local government, and we're offering more services to our citizens. We're also taking some calculated risks to get us to that next level. Yelm's about to do some big things, and I'm ecstatic to be in the room where it happens. Thanks for listening to me.
Great shoes. Yeah. Thank you, Mayor. Very much appreciate your comments. Well, that leaves us with a hidden cleanup, and we're going to be inspired with the great things that Thurston County is doing. Would you please welcome the Commission Chair of Thurston County, Ty Menser.
Jump right on that. All right. Thank you, dude. Good afternoon. First, I want to clarify that I give this report as the outgoing chair of the Thurston County Board of County Commissioners. The board selected our newest commissioner, Commissioner Carolina Mejia, to be our 2022 chair. I twisted her arm just hard enough to get that done. The chair gets to run a lot of meetings, and in January of 2020, I was anticipating being the board chair in 2021, so I volunteered to chair the 2020 Board of Health. I thought I would get some experience running some meetings. 6 weeks later, a global health pandemic hit, so that decision did not work out well for me. But that anecdote connects to the theme of what I want to talk about today. As elected officials, we don't always get to take on, or we're not always able to control what we are tasked to take on. We have to expect the unexpected. When I decided to run for county commissioner, I planned to focus on county finance, criminal justice reform, and land use issues. But what I've actually been consumed with, at least in 2021, is housing and homelessness, COVID-19, systemic racism, and local action on climate change. These are important issues, and I've enjoyed working on them, despite the incredible challenges they present. On housing, The county continues to streamline permitting processes, and early last year, we created a low-income housing exemption for certain impact fees. We continue to support the development of our regional housing council, working with our municipal partners to coordinate funding decisions and housing policy. As Mayor Ryder pointed out, we entered into a partnership with the city of Lacey to acquire a hotel for transitional housing. And we supported Interfaith Works on a new project to add new shelter beds and a day center on Martin Way. Finally, the board has been working through preliminary details with the cities in support of a countywide home fund, a dedicated funding source for permanent supportive housing units and mental health treatment. COVID-19 continues to occupy a large percentage of the county's energy and resources. How to promote and provide vaccinations, how to provide public access to government, manage the safety of our employees, how to preserve public safety and keep the justice system operating safely. These are just a few of the many, many problems we have addressed throughout 2021 and continue to address. Our county's public health staff has been on the front lines of this crisis since day one. And I would ask right now your indulgence that we stop and give those folks a round of applause for all the work they have done to keep this community as safe as possible in this difficult time. We truly appreciate their work. In late 2021, the board passed a resolution to address issues of systemic racism, creating the Thurston County Council on Racial Equity and Inclusion, and adding new county staff to implement the county's forthcoming Racial Equity Action Plan. We supported a shift of focus for Thurston Thrives, the Thurston County Collective Action Health Organization, to put a specific spotlight on health equity. We are partners in this effort with the Thurston Chamber Foundation, Thurston Thrives backbone organization. And I very much appreciated this chamber's focus on these issues in one of its first in-person meetings of 2021, featuring a keynote speaker from the Federal Reserve on institutional racism and its outsized impact on our economy. There's much ongoing work to be done in this area by all of us, and the municipalities are stepping up as well. And Thurston County is committed to moving it forward. Looking ahead, I am convinced that 2022 is going to be a good year for Thurston County. We have fully funded work on our regional climate mitigation plan and will be welcoming a full-time climate coordinator to the county in 2022. We eagerly anticipate final federal approval of our habitat conservation plan, allowing development projects to move immediately forward without unnecessary pocket gopher-related delays. And that's been a long time coming, as I think you all well know. We found a way to meet space needs for a growing county and growing county government without a tax increase and at a fraction of the cost previously projected. And we will thus be moving administrative functions into a renovated building on Pacific Avenue next summer. Finally, the county budget reserve is healthy, and we created the first rainy day fund for unanticipated emergencies in Thurston County history. Thank you for this opportunity to give this update to the chamber. I appreciate what each and every one of you and your businesses do for our community and our county.
Thank you, Commissioner Menser. Outgoing Chair Menser. Thank you, sir. Now's the time for all of you to come right back on up and please take your seats. I'm going to slide the podium back without falling off the edge here. We're going to have a little bit of conversation about several subjects. Time permitting. Oh, jump right through. We're informal. Thank you for using the stairs, Mayor. All right. Well, obviously, you've all touched on the economy and also within the question that we asked in The Voice. Just as a little bit of a preamble, I recently thought it was interesting that a recent Crosscut Elway poll, which they do generally right before the legislature to gauge public opinion on subjects, it marks for the first time since 2014 that the voters named the economy as the state's top issue. You know, it is telling when these were unsolicited, it wasn't a multiple choice. It was just what's on your mind type of survey. Lacey's efforts to support the redevelopment of Woodland District, City of Olympia, working on the arts, as Mayor Selby mentioned, which is a platform for increased economic development. The county's efforts around broadband infrastructure, Yelm's support of Main Street infrastructure, and of course, resolving the water issue. Tumwater, with its craft brewing and distilling, all are examples of how government plays a role in developing economic development platforms and creating the base for the private sector to have success. What else, additionally, do we need to share with the public here today to the chamber? Is there something that was left out? Obviously, you all have your projects in play, but wanted to give you more time to either expand on what you have already shared or even move into new subjects on economic development. And I do, Mayor Ryder, I'm in a position where I can't even see you. So I need my team to flag or you be just very boisterous and step right in for the conversation, okay?
Sure. Well, I'll get things started then, since you called on me.
Have at it. So, thank you.
You know, this past year, we saw the first pre-apprentice construction boot camp that was held in 2021 in partnership with the Lacey's Makerspace, Worksource Thurston, and Anew. This was an exploration program that introduced 10 displaced workers to construction careers over a free 4-week program. All the graduates became proficient in blueprint reading, trades, math, construction, professional development, and construction tools and decision-making tools concepts. And the graduates were also certified in the OSHA 10 flagging and forklift operating. And this was a very successful program that we need to continue to invest more in. Matter of fact, I think we need to have a broader discussion how we continue to focus on labor within our community. You know, we need to continue to invest in vocational and career and technical education. We need to provide support in our local school districts. You know, they have career and technical education as primary venues for students. And of course, we need to support South Puget Sound Community College. We have seen the number of increasing shortages of skilled labor, either mechanics, drivers, plumbers, electricians, you know, other trades. And we need to continue to focus the entire workforce not just those that just want to pursue an advanced degree. So I think that is our next step that we need to continue to be focused on, is making sure that we have the labor that's ready for my business and for your businesses. And that needs to be, I think, a continued primary focus.
Perfect. Other thoughts on workforce development?
Mayor? I guess I'll go.
Oh,
take a shot at it.
Jump right in.
So one thing that I attended back in the day, I graduated high school in 05, and I also attended New Market Skill Center. It's just it's a little bit down the street in Tumwater. But one thing that I would like to see us increase is our partnerships with them. I know our schools already do a lot with them. I would like to see maybe some internships, and it's something that the City of Yelm's actually been doing, working with St. Martin's. So not necessarily a skill center, but we are developing our workforce by making those connections, making those relationships. We have students from the St. Martin School. Cody, what's the department they're working with?
They're
engineering school, and they're developing some of our blueprints for our parks. We're having a new dog park, which I might sound like crazy, but it's our first dog park in Yelm, so it's a pretty big deal. And citizens want it, and they're helping design that and helping in that process. And they're also helping our city park develop some of the other, some of our other infrastructure over there in that area. So we are partnering with them, and I'd like to see an expansion of that. And I would encourage other cities to work with some of these local schools and universities around here that could help bolster up some of our departments and get them that experience as well, get them engaged in local government.
Just recently,
I think last night even, we were talking about this at council with our economic development director, Mike Reed, about working with career-connected learning programs that are already in place, but also creating a pipeline for, you know, our more vulnerable citizens, our younger street-dependent folks that just need that hand on a, you know, on the rung of a ladder to get back into the workforce. And so working with SPSCC to help understand that there is a pathway into the trades for these workers, and then working with specifically the Carpenters Union has a new development center up in DuPont where they can take somebody in with very low skill sets and get them through that program and put them out into the workforce. In like Mayor Ryder said, we're deeply in need of folks to do the kind of building trades that will create the housing that we're so far behind on.
Anyone else?
Was your question about specifically workforce or?
No, it was economic development. And if there's additional things that you would like to share about economic development, obviously workforce and workforce development is an integral part of success of any venture of the private sector to have the skilled individuals. So it segued right into that. So.
Okay, well, I'll chime in. The county is a little different than the cities. With the Growth Management Act says that we've got our municipalities and urban growth areas identified around those municipalities where we centralize our growth. In the rural areas, not lots of different activities aren't permitted. What we do have in our rural area, and I think the Board of County Commissioners feels a special relationship to, is our agricultural community. It's part of Thurston County, and we focus on that. We've got an agricultural business support program that we began. We're working on some policy revisions within our county code to make sure that we don't lose. Thurston County's losing agricultural land at a very high rate relative to other counties, kind of an alarming rate. And so the board has been putting attention on how we can make sure that we don't, you know, we reverse that trend and we protect our important agricultural land, because that's one of the main economic drivers in our part of the county, the unincorporated county. Now, the other part is the urban growth area boundaries. And that's an interesting area because you probably think of them as the city. In fact, I live in the urban growth area boundary for the city of Olympia. But that is permitted and managed by the county. So how do we do that? Well, we do it through our joint plans. And when I got to the board, the joint plans were on the list for the staff, but way down at the bottom. And the municipal leaders like Mayor Ryder, Mayor Selby had come to me and said, you know, can you work on getting these plans updated and prioritize them, because it's kind of inhibiting the way we do our projects and development in those urban growth areas. So we've done that. We've reprioritized those. Those are top of staff's list. We just got a big chunk of a preliminary piece of Tumwater's done, and we're going to, and Olympia and Lacey's are not far behind. A lot of work's gone into that.
I might follow up with that. We're having a joint meeting next Tuesday with the county on that very topic. So that has been a lot of hard work on both the city and our planning commissions to bring that to fruition. One of the things that we're doing is, of course, the brewery and doing all of those, but we also have a couple of other very large projects in the industrial areas. And so one trying to bring in new businesses and retain the ones we have. There's a large building going in south of the airport that will be good. And we're just working on diversifying a lot of the our businesses. One of the concerns we have is with so many state buildings being in Tumwater, you know, what if those buildings are going to become full again, and what use we might be able to transition some of those to. And we're hoping that we can, as state workers come back to the work, that will also help in development in those areas.
Great. So one thing I thought I'd throw out there is the synergies that you collectively create. So the Craft Brewing and Distilling Center, working hard for the craft brewing and cidery as well. Don't want to leave the ciders. They get all over you if you leave them out. But on the grain side, and so when we talk about South County and the Ag Park and the current request in the legislature to fully fund that Commissioner Menser, would you like to share just a little bit of that? And then, Mayor, if you'd like to talk about maybe a little bit about the needs of the craft brewing and distilling industry and how locally we might be making those happen.
Well, this is where I would give a shout out to the Economic Development Council. Aslan Mead, who's taken the lead, as far as I understand, on some of the projects that we had. And some of them are longstanding projects that we're trying to move forward, and some of them kind of got a jump start with COVID, weirdly enough, like the food hub, something that I'd been hearing about as a candidate and way back when, and the COVID-19 pandemic created an opportunity for some people to come together and get a Southwest Washington food hub started, and that's really exciting. And then there's, as David mentioned, the agricultural park near Tenino, and the county's very supportive of that. To the extent that we keep things local, the dollars just circulate, locally, and we've got, I think what you're getting at is you've got an educational piece that's being formed, and we've got, end producer, and then we need that kind of middle of the supply chain infrastructure, and that's what the agricultural park's all about in Tenino.
And your ag lands that are in the county.
Absolutely.
Okay.
One of the items that we're having is, as I mentioned earlier, was the market building that we're going to bring to hopefully fruition here shortly. And one of the most difficult parts is the cost when you go into brewing and distilling and cider making is the equipment cost. And so South Puget Sound Community College has said that their equipment can be used by those organizations, but they need somewhere to have people understand your product and to experience your product. So that's where the market building is going to be very useful. That will provide people with tasting rooms and being able to get those into the market. And then they would be able to grow from there. So I think that will be a really great opportunity. Down the road from that, I believe is planned, is a multi-use building, which has condos above and multi-use retail on the bottom. And so hopefully some of those can kind of maybe drift down that way to that mixed-use building. And so hopefully with an amphitheater, that will also bring in tourists and trade for those individuals that will want to go to those tasting rooms. And again, this does local agriculture that will bring a lot of these products to get it into the marketplace.
I got one more thing.
Jump right in.
One more thing I thought of about the economic development aspect of the arts is the Inspire Olympia campaign, which is the cultural access program funding, would provide dollars for business training for not only established nonprofits, but young startups. It also provides money for board development. It provides money for capital improvements. So it itself is quite the economic generator. So consider that in April.
Yeah, and the arts, one thing that's really intriguing about the arts, if you looked at them in very highly successful communities that have rich, literally economic platforms, you always have high art components. So the question often is chicken or egg. Well, it's both. And you need high quality arts within communities to attract and retain certain kinds of industry sectors and certain kinds of employment bases. So it's a critical strategy, and all the communities are talking about it, and City of Olympia has done an awful lot of work on it. So thanks for letting me interject and just create a little, tie that one up with a bow, why don't we?
Thank you.
Yeah, so ready for the 10,000 pound gorilla, housing, everyone? Yeah. So, housing, when we look at housing, I think it's important to think about it as an ecosystem. And often we get a lot of conversation, rightly so, around homeless and houseless individuals. But really, it is a complete ecosystem. And so my question to get things kicked off, and I suspect we will be having a lengthy conversation, is within the housing, when thinking about it as an ecosystem, subsidized support, housing for ample supply of workforce housing, Mayor Ryder mentioned about that, through middle income and higher income housing supplies. Would you share, and anyone can jump in first here, I'm not going to going to call on someone, but would you share maybe some initial thoughts on our community's efforts? And you can start with your local jurisdiction, or you can jump in more or larger picture, depending where you want to start. But it'll be, please feel free to go any direction you'd like with this. So who wants to jump in? Mayor Sullivan.
So we just last night actually had a meeting in our council work session talking about doing supportive housing and where those areas can go. So we're working on that. We also have an apartment complex that is being built that we provided tax breaks that we had initiated several years ago, and now we finally have a builder that's taking it up on it, to allow 20% of the apartment complex, and it's between Little Rock Road and the freeway, to be have 20% affordable housing. So that's one of our first steps. When we did the Brewery District and also the Capitol Boulevard area, we changed building heights and a lot of zoning, and also are giving more significant breaks to contractors and builders to make permanent affordable housing. We're trying to diversify and not have all of our affordable housing in one area. Also, one of the difficult things is building is the housing stock, and we do have an enormous amount of building going on right now, which is very beneficial, but I still think we're always behind the eight ball. I don't know how we just really need to build a lot more, and so hopefully we can do that in the future, but our population is growing quickly.
Thank you.
I'll go next. I think everyone's aware that Olympia was one of the first cities in the state to pass a missing middle ordinance, which was basically allowing density to be infilled within single family platted neighborhoods. And it met with a lot of, anything new, you get a lot of pushback, a lot of fear. But once people understood what it really could look like, for instance, Jeff and I live in South Capitol neighborhood, and every block has missing middle building in it. We live across from a duplex, a block away from what used to be like a single room occupancy building. There's fourplexes, there's, garden apartments all through our neighborhood, and we all make it work. And so so that was a big step. I think the state is now looking at Representative Bateman, who used to be on the Olympia City Council, is now in the legislature, and she's sponsoring a bill to make missing middle pretty much the norm for cities of a certain size. So the work continues. But we also understand that we cannot move the needle on making up the gap in housing. The latest number is we've underbuilt 250,000 units of housing in the state of Washington. That's monumental. There's no way we can move that needle without partnership with the private sector. Case in point, the most recent development, I mentioned Unity Commons on Martin Way, 60 units of permanent supportive housing with the the shelter component. It was $18 million. So, the home funds, if we combine them together, are close to $7, $8 million a year. So there's no way that we're going to make up that gap without the help of the private sector. And that, the public sector has to, bring something to the table as well, and looking at impact fees and different codes that we need to be a little more flexible on. We understand that as well. So what Olympia also has is what's called a multifamily tax exemption for certain sized units of, like apartments. In our downtown core, what we've done is we've expanded that exemption out through the Martin Way corridor and over into the Capitol Mall area as well. So that'll help encourage, that gives some incentive to builders to build density along those corridors. But it's going to take a silver buckshot approach. It's not going to be one thing.
And I'll jump in here. I do think the region is working better on this issue. And as I talked about earlier about our ADU program, Lacey's the one that started that pre-approved designs, but Olympia and Tumwater has also contributed to that work. And so now we're having some more uniformity across our region. And I think that's what's gonna really is needed here. you know, we shouldn't be providing different incentives in Lacey that's maybe not being provided in other places. We should be working together to have a uniformed approach, because there's just no way one jurisdiction is going to be able to work on this on its own and see success. There has to be some uniformity across the region. And I think we have a lot of opportunities where we have been able to learn from each other. You know, the work that Olympia has done on the Missing Middle, Lacey is now looking at that and trying to expand that on our side. And the work that we have accomplished when it comes to affordable housing, I hope the other jurisdictions, you know, take on some of those ideas as well. But we need to streamline the process as much as we possibly can. It's really difficult to build housing, and it's really expensive. And so we need to continue to find ways to incentivize affordable housing, especially workforce housing. You know, I think that the communities are coming together and are going to make some significant progress on permanent supportive housing. But, you know, I have employees of mine who are desperately looking for a regular affordable, you know, housing, workforce housing. You know, when it costs $3,500 to get into a one bedroom apartment today, that is very difficult for most of our employees. And so we need to have a focus on workforce housing, and that partnership with the private sector is, I think, extremely important. We used to see some sectors build workforce housing for their employees. It'd be interesting to see what that would look like again in some of our sectors, to have workforce housing for certain sectors within our community that maybe can help attract some of those sectors into our region as well.
The county has expanded ADU, ability to have an ADU in the county. We've, as I mentioned in my comments up front, we took advantage of a low income housing impact fee exemption that was available under law, and we implemented that. The county is not going to be where we get the multiplicity of units we need, because we have density limits, but we do hear from developers that time is money. And so what we've done, we've worked really hard on the entire time I've been on the board, is streamlining permitting processes. And what I mean by that is, you would typically previously have three different departments integrated from the county on a building project, and each one had its own communication stream and timeline, and you'd get a letter saying, oh, you're good to go, and that would sound, and you'd think that was the county telling you where you were good to go. No, that was just the environmental health group or the public works stormwater plant, and so people didn't even understand the communication. So we've streamlined communication, created a template that our entire staff works on a project, creates strict timelines so that projects get done and people can predict the amount of time. So we've worked really hard on that. Hopefully that'll help. Going back to Cheryl's point about the, would you say the buckshot approach?
Silver buckshot.
Well, the one thing that really caught my attention is a year and a half or so ago, when Denny Heck was in the House of Representatives, he was a part of a task force that tried to look at the housing shortage and what were the factors. And they evaluated like 10 different, you know, of the main culprits of what is the reason we're not getting enough housing units. And the answer was all 10 of them. I mean, we were so much wanting to find that silver bullet. What is causing this? We'll fix it. If we know exactly what it is, we'll just dive in and fix it. But it's a little bit of a lot of different things, which makes it a really difficult problem.
So kind of echoing everyone else here, one of the biggest things for us in Yelm is, it's important to us, is to eliminate some of that red tape. And everyone's hitting on towards it, but we're reaching out, or again being reached out to, different developers and contractors that are saying, this is what's wrong, this is what's keeping us, preventing us from coming in or from building. Sometimes that's subdividing our properties. I think it's, I don't want to give out, I think it's 6 that you can build on per acre, but we're trying to up that a little bit, or that's the intent, to increase that to help capacity. We also in Yelm have a huge queue of affordable housing that's coming up in the form of apartments. We have duplexes, we have multiplexes up to 4, and we're doing a lot to encourage those developers to come out to Yelm. And if any of y'all know anyone and want to come out to Yelm, you know, we're ready to work with y'all. We want to make it easiest and affordable for you to come out to Yelm, and that also means not raising the taxes on y'all too. So we're not taking that 1% that we could take each year. We're not doing that in Yelm. We're maintaining what we can, what we have in our budget, and we're not increasing it on you. So keeping the cost down for developers and the people that live in Yelm is very important for us.
Add one more thing to that. We recently added duplexes and triplexes to be in all single family zoned areas. And we have also have pre-approved units that are available for the accessory dwellings. Many years ago, we did special zoning for manufactured home parks, so developers could not come in and take out a manufactured home park without going through a process. And we have cottage housing on our books as far as something we want to promote, and that would be another housing option. So we're just hoping that things like that, we're trying to set the groundwork for those, but that builders and developers come in and take advantage of those and start moving those forward.
Excellent. Thank you all for those comments. I think it's exciting to hear that you're looking hard for those arrows to put in the quiver to support the private sector in its ability to house our community, and that's both commendable and appreciated, especially from the chamber. We really appreciate that approach. So with respect to housing, let's just dip down a little bit into the homeless conversation and the houseless conversation of people, and maybe a brief update and course of action for everyone in the audience. And I'm looking over.
I can go first.
Please do.
What we did. So I don't know if we were the first, but I think we were in the county to do a homelessness task force, and it had its ups and downs. I took this on as a city council member, and I co-chaired it with another city council member, Molly Carmody, and we had a bunch of low-income and homelessness advocates on the task force along with us. And you know, whenever you talk about homelessness, there's going to be a lot of people on both sides that are pretty passionate about it. And no one learned that faster than me when we had our community center, the busiest it's ever been, packed full of people that want to comment on this when we've had our when we held our public meetings. And we got a lot of public input. And we came up with about six or seven different options that we thought we would help folks in Yelm that would reduce homelessness, help some of our most vulnerable citizens, and provide resources, from the city's resources, a little bit in form of hosting a community center, but more so on existing resources that have already been provided by the state feds. But the one thing that we came out of this that has been fairly successful for us has been opening up our community center once a month to, it's called a community resource here is what we're calling it. So folks that are homeless, that are either homeless, that are low income, they can come to here, they can come to one spot where all these different agencies are have a little table set up, a little laptop set up where these folks can sign up directly for these services and get the help that they need. Sometimes it's with mental health, sometimes it's with drug addiction, sometimes it's just housing, people down on their luck on for whatever the various reasons that a person could be homeless or have a lower income. They put in one spot an area where they can get that help and that resource and sign up for it. And we've seen multiple people. There's usually between two and five people, and I don't see it seems a lot, but for Yelm, that is a lot. That's a huge amount of our population. When we were back in 2016 or so, we start talking about it, we had about 30 or so in the PIT point in time survey that we did for homelessness. And now that's risen. It's probably around 70, 75, I think, last time. So for Yelm, that's a huge jump for us. But each time we help one of those people get off the streets, find secure and permanent housing, it's a huge win for us. So this has been a very low cost for the people of Yelm, but it's had a huge impact at doing in our little corner of the state. And so it's been a huge help.
Wonderful, thank you. Who else?
I'll talk a little bit more about the home fund concept that was alluded to earlier. Olympia passed a home fund by voter initiative, and it's a 0.1% sales tax, and it's allowed to be used for permanent supportive housing. Those are housing units, but they have services that go with them for folks most in need. Because we know a high percentage of our homeless population struggle with mental health and or substance use disorder issues. It also allows up to 40% to be used for mental health treatment, and it's pretty flexible. It can be for providing services, it could be for buying land, it could be for building actual, you know, brick and mortar. So you can really meet the needs, the localized needs and the evolving needs of the community. Olympia passed this, and our state legislator, Beth Dolio, former legislator, got a change in the legislature that allowed councilmanic action. That means the legislative body can just vote without another ballot initiative. It might have been difficult to pass in Thurston County after Olympia had already passed its. And Olympia is, a lot of folks see Olympia as kind of the centerpiece of where homelessness problems have been focused because services are there for whatever reasons. But we've really, at the county, tried to focus on this as a regional issue. As Mayor Ryder mentioned earlier about not pushing the problem from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, we focus really hard on that. That's what the Regional Housing Council is about. The county is involved in this because we are an agent of state government in terms of allocating state dollars. That's where the county has a big role in housing. It's not that we're building housing in the rural area, it's that we're we divvy out federal and state resources. So Beth Dolio, you know, she was our legislator. She fought really hard to get this changed with us in mind, with Thurston County in mind, because she lives and works and saw the problem that we were dealing with here. So the county had not taken this up. I had mentioned it. I brought it up a couple of times. And finally this year, we were able to take this issue up. And we are collaborating with our other municipal partners on two fronts. We're collaborating on Olympia's side to align what they are already doing, the management, the coordination, the community input, with what we hope to do with our county home fund. We are simultaneously looking at the other jurisdictions who would be now contributing equally, and we've had extensive conversations with City of Lacey and Tumwater about how to coordinate decision-making, make sure everybody's voice is heard. We're really working together. It's not the county controlling the resources. It's us working together to deploy the resource in the best and most effective way for Thurston County. So really excited about this. We're not quite to the finish line yet, but we've had a lot of great discussions and we're getting there.
It's very exciting. I would like to just give people a little bit of an update on, I touched on it in my talk. There's no surprise, there's no question that Olympia is where all the services are for our low-resourced population, our homeless folks, our people struggling with drug addiction and mental illness. I'm proud of the compassion that this community brings forward to serve this population, but it comes obviously with challenges. You know, the pandemic was just one more major stressor on managing this population. We had the Boise versus Martin ruling that came down, and I think right before the pandemic, and that was where we were being told that we could not move people out of an encampment if we did not have a place for them to go. So that pretty much just locked everybody into where they were as far as the encampments. And then when COVID hit, we were also hit with our sheltering system. Our sheltering system was hit because we had to space out all of our shelter and residents. And so we lost about a third of our capacity for shelter. And then the Salvation Army decided to stop their sheltering program. So we lost about 40 beds there. So we were just really, really, it was like a major, major crisis. And so you soon saw more and more of the encampments along DOT property. You see it up and down the freeways along Thurston County now, up the Percival Creek Landing. We had the Deschutes Parkway camp blow up. It was just overwhelming. We were just completely overwhelmed by the need of this population. And so we did the best we could. We got help from the county to do scattered site services. So we would send out crews to do outreach into the camps just to make sure people weren't dying We would have different faith groups stepped in, but we really want to thank the county for helping us do some of the management. It got to be very expensive. We decided finally that we were able to clear the Deschutes Camp Way this fall. There was an eviction moratorium on top of that, right? So there was just, there was no way we could turn. And so, I mean, I just apologize for our business owners. It's just been so, so heavy and hard for our downtown specifically, but the west side as well. There's camps out there in Grass Lake. It's a sign of our times, and I'm so relieved and hopeful that the county is now helping us more and understanding the need for the home fund. But, you know, Mayor Ryder said, you know, it's basically whack-a-mole. You know, you move some people from some, oh, I forgot about the Ensign, right? We had all the RVs along Ensign at the same time, impacting our emergency services for our regional hospital. So, you know, we're digging back out slowly, beginning to start to clear some of the encampments, trying to find people homes as best we can. Again, there's no place for a lot of these people to go. So there's no easy answers, and I wish I had some for you today, but I don't. I just kind of wanted to give you an update that we're trying, and we need all the help we can get.
I do want to say how encouraged I am about Thurston County, Olympia, Tumwater, and Lacey working together on this issue. I think it's extremely important that we're all on the same page going forward, and that we're not doing different things and within our different communities. And so that's why having a regional approach is so important. And also having a regional standards put in place as well. I think that's the next big conversation that we need to have through the jurisdictions that we are all dealing with this very complicated issue in the same manner, right? Because that's what we don't want to happen is Lacey is doing something different than say Olympia is doing, and somehow people are just being moved around. That's not beneficial for anyone. We need more permanent supportive housing. That's a big part of what I talked about today. You know, with the combining of the Olympias and hopefully Thurston County's home funds, we're going to see dollars that we have never seen before. And permanent supportive housing, I know at least in Lacey's case, is our number one priority. And so I think we will finally see some movement in this arena. And it's nice to see that all the jurisdictions will be openly, you know, communicating and collaborating together on this important issue.
And I just want to add one more thing to that. We all need to work in this as a partnership, because this isn't just one jurisdictional areas. And one of the other partners that Tumwater's been working with is the school district, because a lot of that them can identify a lot of the families that are unhoused or couch surfing or those kinds of things. Tumwater doesn't necessarily have as large and noticeable encampments, but we do have our homeless issues. And one of the ways we've been able to identify those at risk is through the school districts, which has been very helpful.
Great. Well, we're running short of time, so I'm actually just going to make a comment instead of throwing it out there as a question. I'm at the podium, so I get that liberty, right? The comment is, one of the partners that has not been on the homeless issue, that has not been part of the conversation, has been the state of Washington. And so I think we have some real positive movements, as Mayor Ryder mentioned with Challenge Seattle, and Mayor Selby mentioned about the state infusing direct capital dollars for housing, as well as the needed wraparound services. So we'll save that for an ongoing conversation on how we influence the legislature and how we provide support locally. So with that, I'm gonna turn the podium back over to Michelle Wickett, but I wanna thank all of the mayors and of course the outgoing chair of the county commission for their time today. If we could just thank them all, and we will then allow them to exit the stage. Great. So thank you.
Thank you again, Mayors and County Commissioner Menser, for your program. It was very good and obviously enlightening. There's an awful lot going on there. So we're going to do a quick drawing for a chamber free lunch next month. And just to let you know, next month's forum will be held at St. Martin's. And it will be on childcare and the crisis that we have going on there. So we have Anthony Varela with Century 21. You'll be getting a free lunch next month. So thank you all for attending. We look forward to seeing you next month. And have a safe rest of this month.
Thank you.